my PhD evaluation committee members for their guidance and support. Professor Tim Finnan, Dr. MBS, who's present with us in the room, Dr. Dushara, and my advisor, Dr. Bilke. I would also like to thank all the audience members and faculty who come and joined us. So before I actually delve on into the details of my PhD work, I would just want to discuss the impact and power of social media in our everyday lives today. There are different kinds of social media that exist today, from Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, Instagram, Pinterest, etc. With each having its own user base and its own attributes. And here are some of the statistics to show the reach and the volume of content that is posted on social media. Facebook has about 1.44 billion monthly active users. The volume of content can be got by the fact that Twitter gets about 500 million tweets every day posted. And YouTube has about 300 hours of video uploaded every minute. So that's the kind of volume that we are looking at. Now, social media also has a direct impact on everyday real-world events that happen. For example, the Egyptian revolution, which has happened in the last few years, has actually been, all its success and acceleration has been attributed to the movement through the social media. Similarly, recently during the Nepal-India earthquake, we saw how social media was effectively used by government and public to coordinate relief efforts, doing communication among the people, etc. But once on the one side we have the good side, but there have also been multiple incidents throughout last few years in which we have seen misinformation being spread through the social media. For example, we discuss a few cases. For example, during the recent Ebola outbreak that happened, there were multiple rumors that came on social media saying that of potential cures, and people worst affected by these by the Ebola actually started believing them, and it led to death and hospitalization of many people. Similarly, during an incident in 2012, there were rumors spread on Twitter saying that there's been a shootout in Mexico City, and because of which the entire city came to a standstill, with parents running to the schools to get their children, accidents happening on the road, and things like that. I'm on slide number 5. During the case of Boston bombings, we saw there were numerous Facebook and Twitter pages that were set up by malicious entities to capitalize on the tragedy, to come up with these fake charity pages in which they were fooling people to donate money for the victims. Back home in India, we saw a similar incident during the Assam riots that happened, and the government had to take extreme measures in blocking certain URLs and handles of people on Twitter and other social media in order to curb those rumors. So among all the social media that exist today, the focus of my work has been primarily on Twitter. And one of the major reasons being, it's one of the most prominent news and public medium today. It is the medium on which, out of all the social media, which is the most discusses newsworthy topics and which is in general public in nature. So this is what a typical Twitter profile looks like. On the left, we have the user descriptions, like the profile photograph, the username, then the location of the user. And on the right side, I'm on slide number 6, we have the tweets that are posted by the account. And on the top, we can find some of the statistics, like how many people are connected to this account. That is, they have started to follow the account. So in particular, these three are example of tweets that were spreading misinformation. So on the left, you'll see this tweet shares an image which was shared during the Hurricane Sandy, and it said that a McDonald's in Virginia has been flooded. This tweet was not only fake, it was from a McDonald's in Japan 4 years prior to Hurricane Sandy. Just because of the fact that it was posted during the hurricane and the ensuing chaos, people actually believed it to be true. It became highly viral and people started flooding the area with the fear that the area is being flooded. the tweet on the right top by the Associated Press, the account when it was compromised, it was a very popular incident that happened. The tweet was online only for 8 minutes. Within 8 minutes, it was brought down. Yet it caused the US Dow Jones Index to fall beyond 1500 points, causing high number of financial losses. Then this was a tweet on the right bottom that was spread during London riots. During London riots, which went on for 10 to 15 days, there were numerous rumors that came up on social media every day saying what's happening on the ground. And because of rumors like London Zoo has been broken, there was a fear and panic that was spread among the people leading into it. Yeah. So the aim of my thesis was that if you can design and evaluate techniques to mitigate this misinformation spread on microblogging services. So the solution we proposed for this was that if we can come up with a algorithm or a framework in which we can assess the credibility or trustworthiness of content that is being posted on Twitter in real time. And for doing that, we came up with a learning to rank model to assess that credibility of tweets. The model was based on 20 real world events data that we collected in the last 3 years, and the system was evaluated in a year long experiment. We had about 1800 real Twitter users, and these users used TweetPred to evaluate 14.2 million tweets in their browsers. So before I begin, I'll show a short demo of the tool that we developed. So this is how, it's a tool that works inside your Twitter environment itself. So if you can see, like the tweets as they are loaded in the timeline, a 7-pointer scale score appears right next to each of the tweet. So we wanted a system that is integrated within the Twitter environment to serve the users the best, so that they don't have to go to another interface to check what is the credibility or trustworthiness of the content. It's a 7-point scale in which lower the rank, lower the credibility, and higher the rank, higher the credibility. And we also gave the users a feature in which they can let us know whether they agree or disagree with our score. Like if they agree, they can give the system feedback that they agree with the score, and if they disagree, they can let us know, and they can also help us find out the correct credibility by marking. So that's how the system works. We eventually come to how we build this. So here is the approach we followed in solving a research aim. In the first part, we actually took certain case studies. We took certain real world events that were happening, like Hurricane Sandy, Boston Blast, Mumbai Blast, Hurricane Irene, Oklahoma, earthquakes. And we analyzed each of these events in detail for the rumors, fake content, fake images, and misinformation being spread during these events. We analyzed who are the people who start these fake rumors. What is the network and temporal properties of this rumor spread? And then using the insights from the first part, we built our learning to rank model, for which we used SVM rank and pseudo relevance feedback. And finally, in the third phase, we molded the model that we built in part two to a real world deployment and evaluated for it over a year. So for all the experiments and events data that I discussed throughout this thesis, we needed data, and for that we set up a 24/7 data collection in one of our servers in IIIT, and we collected over 2 million tweets from 2011 to 14, and from this data set we used to select certain events to be for our analysis. So now I move on to the first part, that is characterizing the misinformation spread during certain events. For time constraints, I would probably not be able to go through all. I would discuss at least two events in some. So the first event that we studied was Hurricane Sandy. Hurricane Sandy hit the American coast in 2012. Till now, it's considered one of the bigger hurricanes that has hit America and caused a lot of damage.
Professor Finan?
Yes.
Are you with us?
I'm okay here, yes, I'm following.
Jusara, you're following us?
Yes.
I'm sorry, what?
No, I spoke to another evaluator on the Skype.
So these are examples of the three of the fake images that were spread during Hurricane Sandy. The first one we discussed, the second one, if you see, it's a street in New Jersey that has been photoshopped with a shark. And that also became one of the very viral images. The third one is also a photoshopped image of the skyline of New York. So these were three of the few images which became very viral during the hurricane. So overall for this event, we collected about 1.7 million tweets, out of which we found that about 10,000 tweets contained fake images, and about 5,000 of them contained real images. So then we did different network temporal, etc. analysis for these. So this was one of the analysis we did for the network analysis. In this graph, the nodes represent a user, and the number here is a user ID on Twitter for that particular user. And the edge represents if there is a retweet or a reply connection between two users. If user 1 retweets user 2, there is a connection. So this was in the first hour after the fake image was introduced, and this was in the second hour. And we can see that within an hour, the fake tweet suddenly becomes very viral. And also there are, and the nodes are sized according to the degree centrality. And we can see there are a few users with very high degree centrality who were primarily responsible for the spreading of fake images. And if you see, the person who started the fake image is not the one who was responsible for making it viral. Because this ID is somewhere up there and it's not that effective. So it was initiated by somebody else. And then it was picked up by some other person who had more reach, and because of that, finally the image became viral of being in the network. So after doing the network analysis, we wanted to study what role does the follower network of Twitter plays in the propagation of fake image. For this, we created two graphs. We first crawl the follower network for all the users who were tweeting the fake image, and then we took two graphs. The first one was in which the nodes were the users and the edges were the retweets, and in the second one the edges were if I'm connected to the other user by the following. So using this, we found out the intersection of the two graphs, and we found only an 11% intersection. So what does this result basically mean? It means that the follower network of Twitter was responsible only for about 11% of spread of fake images, and this was quite in contrast to the existing literature and norms at that time, which used to say that the Twitter network is the follower network of Twitter is the primary reason for content or images to become viral. So then we applied classification to see if we can distinguish between the tweets that contain fake images versus tweets that contain real images. So for doing that, these are the features that we considered. Some of the features were based on the user attributes. Who's the user who's sharing this fake image on Twitter? What are the number of followers? Does the Twitter has a URL? Is the user verified or not? And similarly, we had tweet-based features like does the tweet contain pronouns? Is this, we have negative sentiment words. So these were the results we got. We got that the tweet-based features were much more effective than user-based features. We got very high accuracy, and one of the reasons we attributed this was since the data that we have was of the most viral content, hence it had a very high number of retweets, because of which there was a text similarity, and because of which the results were so high. Hence for all the other experiments that we did after this, we selected random data rather than viral data for doing this similar analysis. So next case study that I'll discuss would be Boston Blast. Boston Blast happened in 2013. And this the aftermath of Boston blast actually showed a lot of prominence for social media. The first image for Boston blast to occur in any sort of a media was on Twitter, and that was within 4 minutes of the blast. And during 1 week after the blast, there was a manhunt for the suspects, in which Boston police effectively used social media to give out images of the suspects and people sent in clues. So this was one event that was tracked and generated a lot of activity on social media. Hence, we decided to study this event in detail. These were the two fake retweets that were spread during these blasts. The first one, like you can see, said that an 8-year-old boy has died in the explosion, and it actually had the photograph of the boy, and that boy was completely unharmed. And the second tweet said that for every retweet, they are going to donate $1. And this tweet became so viral that it got more than 50,000 retweets. So for this event, in all we collected about 7.8 million tweets. This is the timeline for the data we collected, and most of the peaks in the data represent the events, real world events that were happening correspondingly. Like the police taking out the image of the suspects being caught, etc. This is a number of geolocated tweets we got. So, now for this entire set of data that we collected, the next step was to identify the true, the fake, and the generic content. For doing this, we took the 20 most viral content that was being spread and tagged it into the three categories of true, fake, and generic. And we got about 6 rumors that we identified that we got most viral, 7 true news, and 7 generic. And for each of these were the amount of tweets that we got. And we can see that about 30%, 29% of the data that got most viral during Boston blast was actually rumors and fake content. So these were the user profiles that were sending that fake content. If you see, one of the blast happened on 15th April. So if you see, so these 4 accounts were responsible for all the 6 rumors. 2 of them were responsible for 2 rumors each. And if you see, the second account was created on April 15th itself, and it had the name Boston Marathons, which was very similar to the official account of Boston Marathon. And because of that, people got confused, and they immediately acquired 297 followers, and the rumors that were spread by them became highly active. Most of the accounts spreading these rumors and the others were suspended, but like you can see, the last one was not. The reason being, it was one of the sports agencies which had by mistake given out a wrong information, which became highly viral, and then they did a lot of apologies and taking care of that the rumor doesn't spread any further. So that's why the account is still active. So this is a temporal pattern for these rumor and fake content. If you can see that in the first 7 to 8 hours is the time that the rumors get the most viral. So that is the timeline in which we need to do something in order to curb misinformation. As soon as an event occurs, there is a lot of vulnerability and chaos among the people, and that's the time they believe any information that is being posted on social media. So when we analyze the source or the medium from which people are tweeting for these fake and true rumors, we found that about 76% of the rumors were coming from mobile, as compared to only 51% of general tweets like pray for Boston being coming from mobile. That's also something. So now that we had a set of rumors and tweets, we wanted to identify that if we can use user attributes, that is attributes of users who are sharing a rumor, to predict how a particular rumor, how viral a rumor would get in future. For doing that, we used linear regression, and for about 5 out of the 6 rumors, we were able to use a combination of all user attributes like follower, friends, favorites, etc. to predict till a good level of how well the removal hit. So this concludes my part one, and apart from being published as papers, the work done for Hurricane Sandy and Boston was also featured by Fast Company and Wired and got included as a chapter in the book. So now I come to the second phase of my work, in which we would aim to build our learning rank model using real world events data to find out the credibility of content. For doing this, I would first just give a background of what kind of tweets come when an event happens. So these are three tweets, like you can see. All three of them contain the word Hurricane Irene. But only the first tweet actually has any tangible information about the event. The second tweet is an opinion of a person. And third tweet is actually an Amazon product ad in which they have just included the Hurricane Irene word for getting it viral. So our task was that when we get tweets for an event, we need to select which of these tweets contain information, which of the tweets have no information about the event. And among the tweets which have information, how can we find out which of the tweets are trustworthy or credible and which of them are not credible? So how do we define credibility? So Oxford Dictionary describes credibility as a quality of being believed. So for us, we define credibility of a tweet as something that when a user sees a tweet content, can he believe that content or not, based on the attributes of the content and the user who's posting that message. So this was a framework that we followed for building our learning to rank model. We first took tweets from the Twitter streaming API, and then we collected tweets for different events. Once we had the tweets for the events, the process was a two-step process, one in which we selected about 500 randomly selected tweets for each of the events, and they got them annotated from users for their credibility score. And on the other hand, we used the same tweets to generate the feature vectors and apply ranking and pseudo relevance ranking to obtain our results. Finally, we evaluated the results that we got. So these were the 14 different events that we considered and the number of tweets for each. We tried and get a mixed batch of different sort of events like US downloading and Apple CEO World Financial kind of events. Then we have some earthquakes, then we have some India-based events. So we took these 14 high-impact world events for a time period and applied. The annotation we applied was a two-step annotation in which we showed each tweet to the user along with the event to which it belongs to and asked them to annotate whether they feel that the tweet contains some information about the event or do they feel the tweet does not contain any information about the event. Is the tweet related to the event at all or not? Or if they cannot mark the tweet. From the tweets that got marked as R1, that is tweets that have information, we asked them to mark the credibility according to them. And these were the people to whom we had provided what the event was, what kind of rumors were spread during the events, and were all computer science people who had a knowledge about the subject. So these were the annotation results. We got each tweet annotated by around 3 people. I think the annotated event was 0.7. And we got that about 30% of the tweets in all posted about an event contained any sort of information about that event. And only 17% of it was credible. So now for this task, this was the set of feature sets we used. And the evaluation metric we used was MECG, which is a standard metric that is used for graded results, since our results were in a form of a rank. This was the results for the first phase. The baseline that I've kept is the recency. Recency is in the order in which tweets are shown today in the Twitter network. That is in order of the occurrence. So we saw that both tweet and user-based features were able to give us equally good results. Now in order to improve these results further, we decided to apply pseudo-relevance feedback. Now pseudo-relevance feedback, which is also called as blind relevance feedback, is basically a re-ranking technique in which we take the ranking results from our initial set, apply another ranking based on the top returned rank results from the first ranking. So I can probably explain it here. This is the initial set of tweets we had. We applied the SVM rank using the feature sets we showed and we obtained the ranking T dash. Now based on the top K results for this ranking, we re-extracted the most frequently occurring words to define the context for each of the event or do a query expansion for each of the event. And finally, we used a similarity matrix to re-rank these top T dash to TK to T double dash. So by doing this two-step process for ranking, we were able to improve our results. So finally, coming to the last phase of my work, in this the analysis that we did till now has all been in a post hoc environment in which events have already happened. We have a lot of historical data about the events. We have a lot of historical data about the user. We have all the tweets about an event, and that help us in judging and making any decision. But to make a difference in the real time, we decided to take this model and convert it into a real time model in which we can access the credibility of each singular tweet, irrespective of which event or which keyword it belongs to. So for doing, and this was available as a Chrome extension on the Chrome Web Store, and that's a demo that we saw. And it is also available as a REST API for developers who often ask for tokens for it. So we expanded our feature set, but we also removed a lot of features which were dependent upon the event or the historical data of the user. Now all 45 features that we used were only dependent on that singular tweet data that comes to us. And we included a lot of features like, since we have URLs in a tweet, we included what's the repetition of the URL. We included things like if a YouTube video is being included in the tweet, how many likes or dislikes does the YouTube video have as a feature for our work. And that's how we aim to increase. So these were the events that we added, and this time we used Crowdflower, which is a known annotation service in the research community for our work. And this was the two-step annotation process like before, and these are the results we got. So this time we tried applying different ranking algorithms other than SVM rank to see if we can perform better. And there were two metrics that we were looking at this time. The first one was MECG to find out how good our results are. And the second was, since it's a real-time system, we also wanted to look at time, since response time is one of the important factors that we need to consider. So we saw that as the value for, we increase the value of K more, the difference between the best uplink warning percent and SVM rank became similar. But the training and testing time for SVM rank was considerably smaller than any other. And keeping the real-time system in mind, we decided just to implement SVM rank model for our pre-learn model. These were the top 10 most important features that we found were helping in rank, the credibility ranking of our work. We found that number of characters in a tweet, the user has location in his profile, or the number of retweets for that particular tweet, and the ratio of the number of statuses and followers that are the user profile attributes played a key role in defining the credibility. So this is how we implemented the model that we have learned for assessing credibility. So this is when a tweet is loaded on the Twitter profile. The browser plugin sends a request with the tweet ID and the API token to our server. Over there, we fetch all the tweet details from Twitter and compute the 45 feature vector. Finally, we compute the credibility score using the pre-learned model that we just evaluated. And finally, we send the score back to be displayed next to the tweet. So that's how the system is implemented in the backend. And this is the feedback feature that we also gave to the users, which I demonstrated. These are overall statistics. For the work, in all, the system was deployed for over a year. Actually, it is still on. It's a live system which is on Chrome Web Store, which we publicize using the same link. And these users are users across the globe, 1800 users who have started using our system. And till now, they have used about, they have seen credibility scores for more than 14.2 million tweets. And we have more than about 650 to 700 weekly active users on our system consistently. Now, who are the people who are using this system? Among the, apart from the general users, we have a lot of emergency, not a lot of, but some of the emergency responders, people, firefighters, who are using the system in our daily life, because they monitor social media for news updates and updates about new emergency situations in their area. So that's what they look for. Journalists and news media who are looking for potential news and information on social media, and some other researchers who probably would like to use it as a feature in their work. Then there were certain parameters on which we evaluated our system. That is, what is the usability and what is the response time? So for usability, we asked our users to take up an anonymous survey in which we had some system usability questions and some demographic questions, and we got a score of 70. And for the response time, we got that for about 83% of the users, we were able to show the credibility score within 6 seconds of their tweet being loaded. So that was how we fared up in terms of response time. So the work done on the credibility part, both the two parts, was also picked up by New Yorker and Washington Post, and also got features in digital humanities. So now I would like to discuss the limitations and future work for my work. So one of the primary limitations and what I would like to do in future is that currently I could focus only on Twitter. It would be probably be more useful, and if I can take the models and the framework built for Twitter to other social media, at least similar ones, like which are also used for information sharing and communication. The second one, apart from just credibility, one important factor that come in crisis management and emergency response is that there are other factors that people like to know in addition to credibility, like what are the tweets which are factual, which have facts or details about the event, which are the tweets that are timely or which are novel, which show new information which till now nobody has shared about the event. So these are the kind of things that we are currently working on to include in addition to the credibility or trustworthiness. So here's a summary of my contributions like I discussed. The first one was to analyze certain real world events in detail to find out how misinformation is spread, what are the temporal and the network attributes of the same. The second one was to coming up with a learning to rank framework to assess the credibility. And the third one was that deploying this as a system in a real world experiment. So my list of publications for the same, I was unfortunately not able to cover all of them. Like, and with this, I would like to end my slides, and I'm open to any questions and questions.